أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون أيام معدودات فمن كان منكم مريضا أو على سفر فعدة من أيام أخر وللذين يقيتونه فدية طعام مسكين فمن تطوع خيرا فهو خير له وأن تصوموا خير لكم إن كنتم تعلمون صدق الله العظيم. These verses which I've read are the ones with which the short section in the Holy Quran about fasting begins. And I will go through some highlights of these few verses, of which there are six in all. It begins as follows: Ya ayyuha allatheena amanu kutiba alaykumus siyamu kama kutiba alal ladheena min qablikum لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. O you who believe, fasting is prescribed for you as it was prescribed for those before you. Now the reason I've paused there, the verse doesn't end there, but I've paused there. O you believe, fasting is prescribed for you as it was prescribed for those before you. It doesn't finish there, but it has two further words. But generally, Muslims seem to think that that's all they need to know as far as I've gone. And those two words which follow, well, there are two words in Arabic, and it's more than two in English. So that you may guard against evil. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. So there, when instructing Muslims to fast and setting up the institution of fasting, directly Allah has mentioned one of the goals to be attained through fasting, that one must try to attain through fasting. There are others mentioned later on as well, but this is the first one of them, that you may learn to guard against evil. If someone, as many, a huge number of people do, fast merely in the physical sense, but then they don't care to concern themselves with any of the goals set in the Holy Quran to be attained through fasting, then this is the reason why we find that people remain the same. They don't become any better year after year as a result of fasting, because they are not even trying to, even attempting to attain any of those goals. They perhaps don't consider them important. And it's made worse by the fact that they actually believe that they are carrying out the commandment of Allah. As far as they can see, they are fasting from morning to from dawn to dusk. So, since they come to believe that they fulfill the commandment given by God in total, they feel they don't need to do any more, and that anything else is therefore unimportant. And this has always been a danger in any religion, that people come to think or consider that they have obeyed some commandment of God, which usually is something in the outward or ritual sense. And they think that that then gives them a blank check to carry on behaving as they were behaving before. So the first goal here, laid down by the Holy Quran, the very first verse, is that you may learn to guard against evil by means of fasting. And it's quite obvious how that can be done. That during the fast, you learn to have control and mastery over your basic desires. When people carry out any kind of wrongdoing, it might be something sophisticated, but in the end, it's all to do with satisfying your desires of hunger, thirst, or sexual desire. It all boils down to that. Any kind of wrongdoing is to satisfy those desires, the very ones which we learn to control and have mastery over through fasting. Then, while fasting, of course, the deprivation causes discomfort and a bit of hardship, which we bear. And that's also the same kind of discomfort and hardship you will feel, or we will feel, if we try to give up some bad habit. So, you are practicing in fasting how to persevere, how to withstand the hardship and discomfort that you have to undergo when trying to give up some particularly long-standing bad habit. And then, as we know in fasting, with a bad habit, one wishes to do it permanently. During fasting, it's only for a few hours. I think all of us must have realized during fasting that you feel hungry at certain times when you would be eating, especially in the early fast. But when that time passes, then you stop feeling hungry. And you might feel as energetic as ever. And so what that teaches us is that if you restrain yourself from some kind of wrongdoing, then you'll feel the urge to do it. But in time, that will pass. And it will pass because although you felt you needed to do something, you didn't actually need to. It was only just some sort of a psychological need. And therefore, it was not a real need. So that's another way in which we learn how to guard against evil through fasting, which is the first goal there, laid down by the Holy Quran. And the next verse goes on to say that fasting, which has been prescribed for you, is for a certain number of days. But whoever is sick or on a journey, they should fast a similar number of days, meaning a similar number of days after the appointed period, which is the month of Ramadan. What illness is or what a journey is, really a person can determine for him or herself. Although our books of jurisprudence define lengths of journeys, or maybe they also try to define illness. But that really is up to the individual. But then they are obliged, after Ramadan, at whatever point they have recovered or the journey has ceased, to fast to make up for the missed fast. But then the Holy Quran goes on to say that for those who find it extremely hard, then they may effect a redemption by feeding a poor person. In other words, there are people who can not only not fast in Ramadan, but even afterwards, they're not in a position for personal for reasons of health and strength, that is. They're not able to do it. So they're required to give money or feed one poor person. It's laid down somewhere with the average food they themselves would be eating. I don't think it's the average food that person would be eating. Otherwise, you could select someone really poor. So, for each fast. And then in the next verse, the Holy Quran tells us that Shahrul Ramzan alladhi unzila fihi al-Quran, that the month of Ramadan is that in which the Holy Quran was revealed. This is a well-known verse, you will have all heard it many times before. Of course, when the Holy, what that means is that the revelation of the Holy Quran to the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam started in the month of Ramadan. Obviously, at that stage, there was no Islam as we know it wasn't, didn't exist. So Ramadan wasn't a Muslim month of fasting in that sense. And so, it's because of that that the revelation of the Holy Quran began in that month of the Arabian calendar, that this month was selected for fasting. And I think I'm right in saying, I may be out by a year or so, but this must be the 1400th anniversary of the start of the revelation of the Holy Quran in solar years. Because the first revelation came to the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I believe in the year 609. He lived after that 23 years, which brings us to 632 CE when he died. So 609. And so 1400 years after that is 2009. But because that's in solar years, therefore Muslims don't attach any significance to that. 1400 lunar years passed a long time before this, about 40 years or so. And I remember, I think I was quite young at the time, that the 1400th anniversary of the revelation of the Holy Quran was marked. Our Jamaat in Pakistan did something in connection with it as well, around 1970. But anyway, in solar years, this is the 1400th anniversary. And this verse goes on to tell us as to what the Holy Quran's function is. That it is a guidance to all mankind. And it contains proofs of that guidance, arguments showing that that guidance is true and why it's necessary. And that it is also Furqan. Furqan is the name of the Holy Quran in the Quran, which is mentioned perhaps twice or more. And what that means, the word Furqan means something which distinguishes between right and wrong, good or bad. It's the criterion by which you judge what is right, what is wrong. Furqan is related to the word Farq, because it makes a difference. It shows you the difference. And so that verse then goes on to say that whoever of you witnesses the month, then he should fast in it. It's because of these words, witnesses the month, that you see people trying to look out for the lunar crescent so that someone bears witness that I've seen the lunar crescent and the new month has begun. And it then goes on to say, of course there are parts of the world, the polar regions, north and south, where a month as such, or in fact a day as such, in the sense we know it, doesn't exist. And this says whoever you witnesses the month. So this has been used to suggest that you can't fast in those regions according to the sunrise or sunset there. Because for say 4 months it will be, the sun will be out all the time, for 4 months it will be dark. And in between, there's a very short period when the days is of the normal length, but it's a very short period. And in this verse then, Allah goes on to say that Allah desires ease for you, and He doesn't desire hardship for you, and He desires that you should complete the number of fasts and exalt His greatness, and that you may give thanks. So here Allah tells us that it's not His desire to put us to all this hardship, but that we have to do it in order to gain something from it. And it says, and that you may give thanks. So that is another goal to be achieved through fasting, which is to become thankful. Now every person, whether he's holy or far from God, whatever they might be, when you become used to blessings and possessions of all kinds, then you cease being thankful, you cease appreciating them, and then even if you a little reverse, even if you lose some small thing in all that you've got, then you feel as if you've suffered a huge loss. Whereas compared to someone who doesn't have any of those things, your loss isn't anything at all. So it's only, so long as you have things, you may give thanks to Allah in words, which is quite easy. But real appreciation only comes through feeling what it is like to be deprived. So being thankful then is another goal of fasting. And earlier I should have mentioned when dealing with the, when mentioning that if you can't, you're completely unable to fast, you should feed a poor person. That illustrates another goal of fasting. That someone who can't fast has to feed a poor person to get the same sort of benefit without fasting. This means that someone who is fasting, he should have concern through his deprivation for people who haven't got any food. So if you can't fast, then you can get some of it by actually feeding a poor person. So that then is another goal of fasting. I think the time has come now. That one should have concern, practical concern, for those who get much less to eat than what we do. And there are only two others which I'll quickly mention. That the next verse in the Holy Quran says that, O Prophet, tell people that, O Prophet, when my servants ask you about me, tell them that I am near. I answer prayers when people call on me, so they should hear my call and believe in me and walk in the right way. So attaining nearness to God is then another goal which we should try to attain through fasting. And here this reciprocal relationship is mentioned, that I answer the call of the person who prays, so they should hear my call. So another goal is to develop that kind of relationship where you feel God is near. You pray to Him and your prayers are answered, and then you answer His call. And lastly and very briefly, in the last verse in that section, the Holy Quran tells Muslims that you shouldn't swallow up property among yourselves by false means. in other words, by committing fraud, take what doesn't belong to you, nor should you try to gain access to the authorities so you can bribe them to take away other people's property and rights. So that is also related to fasting, that you don't take wrongfully what is not yours and deprive others. And unfortunately, that continues to happen. People continue to do that despite the fact that they fasted. So I'll end there because the time has come.